Hello, everybody. Welcome to episode 12 of the AndersMill podcast. I'm your host, Emily, and welcome to my home. Thank you so much for joining me today. Watson's down here kind of thinking about, does he want to sit with me? Does he want to just roam around the house? Just to let you know, my husband is home, so there may be some interruptions from that. He has a tendency to make noise because he is another human being. Otherwise, the apartment and the apartment complex is scarily quiet right now. So, as per usual, we might have some barking from Watson. Huh, Bubba? Do you want to come sit on Mama's lap? Yeah? Come on. Come on, you can make it. There's so many projects in the way, he says. There we go. Oh, wait, what are we doing? Oh, well, you can't sit like that because people can't see me and they can only see the back of your beautiful head. Yeah. Well, we'll see how things go. I think I'm going to do things a little differently today in that I have been thinking about the podcast for a while. And I've been trying really, really hard to stay within a certain time frame. And that makes me feel really rushed when I'm podcasting. And I feel like I miss a lot of things. Like I'm not really making a connection. Like it's more of a chore to podcast when I put myself on a time crunch than it is fun. And then when I'm editing, I'm sitting there thinking, okay, what can I cut out? Man, this is really long. Nobody's gonna wanna watch it this long. And I'm just second guessing myself a lot. And I don't want the podcast to be a burden. And so I'm gonna take away the constraint of a timestamp. And by doing that, the podcast may be extra long. And maybe I might even have to break it up into two episodes, as in like part one and part two. So people might feel it's more approachable that way. And that might be what I do. We'll wait and see what the length of today's podcast is and take it from there. I know today will be a little long because I have so much to talk about. There's so much goodness and yumminess surrounding me to the point that I actually brought, sorry, Watson's on my lap. So I brought myself a little snack of a rice cake. Oh, he got really excited. I love the popcorn ones. And then I've got myself a drink. Mary Poppins, my favorite mug, and now my husband's favorite mug. We argue over who gets to use this now, especially when we're drinking tea. But today it's ice water. So I'm all set, right? So let's just dive in and see where the journey takes us. And let's just all take a deep breath and say, Emily, let's just talk. Let's just connect. How's that? Instead of feeling that pressure, okay? So, let's jump in. Oh, I guess you want to know where to find me. So, I'm AKA Millie on Ravelry, and I'm AKA Millie907 on Instagram. And I currently have a WordPress blog, which is under the name of AndersMillknits. Okay, so, here's me interrupting myself from earlier. So I totally forgot to tell you about something that's really fun. And I can't get my computer to turn back on. Maybe I lost my battery. Earlier this week, Stephanie from Hot Pink Socks texted me and she said, hey, how would you like to do a swap with the theme of spring? No, I'm like, oh yes, please, because I've been having it in my head that I wanted to do a swap with the group, but I didn't know how to approach it because I was like, oh, do we have enough people or would enough people want to do it? And Stephanie's just like, let's do it. She goes, I'll be in charge of everything. I'll take care of everything. And she has been. It's been awesome. So on the Ravelry group of AndersMillKnits, Stephanie started a thread for the spring swap, and she's put in all the details there. The budget is $30, and we're going to do a skein and a little something nice if you have enough money around it, and little goodies that remind you of spring. And you need to let us know if you can ship internationally or you want to go domestic. And with that, she's come up with, I think, 3, maybe 4 questions. I don't know. I filled it out a couple days ago around your likes and dislikes so that whoever you get paired up with will have something to go off of. So, like, for instance, one of the questions is, what colors of spring do you like? And for me, I'm not really a browny person. I'm not really like a muddy brown that you see in spring. I don't really like that. I do love the bright, fresh, crisp colors of the new leaves coming out. And I love the flowers poking up from the ground. And I talked about that in my little post about how I hope is my favorite thing about spring. So if you would like to join up, that would be amazing. And I've never done a swap like this before. It's been quite a few years since I've done a swap period. And I'm really excited to do it. So, you know, go on over to the Ravelry group, check it out, see if you'd like to join. And if you do, go ahead and fill out the little form. I do ask that you be a member of the group in order to participate. So if you are not a member when you go over there, just click the join now button. You know, if after the swap you don't want to be a member of the group, go ahead and unjoin. It's not going to hurt my feelings, guys. Don't worry. But I hope you come over and partner up with us and have a wonderful time doing a little spring swapperoo. And let's just get all in the spirit of happiness and joy. That's what I'm looking for. Okay, now back to your normally scheduled programming. So, let's talk about the last few weeks, shall we? So let's jump right into reviewing notes. The last 2 weeks have been great. Valentine's Day came and went, and some other events came and went. I went to Madrona this last weekend and had a wonderful weekend with not just my husband, but with the fiber world in general. It just gives me shivers to think about it. But prior to that, let's start at the beginning. So I didn't mention this last episode because I hadn't received my package, which literally I finished the episode and I got the notification that I had the package in the mail. And I was like, you've got to be kidding me. But I wasn't going to go back and edit things. So, but my friend Stephanie and I decided that we were going to do a mini skein swap. And why is this one out of one of them? I know, because I finished this one. Just, okay. And so we decided to do 15 little minis together. And so during the Super Bowl, I skeined up 15 little minis and put them in little bags. And the reason I have them separated into 5s is because on the opposite side, I made a little chart, which obviously I just, you know, winged it. So there's mistakes and stuff. Of what each of them were, and I wanted them to be kind of self-explanatory. So, like, for instance, I sent her some of my yarn from when AndersMill was dying yarn. And so this is the Tundra Strong Base in the Wooster colorway that I sent her. I love Jeeves and Wooster. And then, for instance, let's see, I've got some Ella Ray from the Pure Joy shawl that I just finished. And then, let's see, the Hazelknits. Oh, gotta love Hazelknits, right? Those were some socks I knit up for, I think, my best friend. I think. It's not on my project page. I have discovered that I am horrible at project page stuff. So, you guys will recognize this, though, the last two. My Opal Love Story. Those were the socks that I finished up a couple episodes ago. Well, before Christmas. And then my wedding socks. I had enough left to do some mini skeins in that. So this is Lolo Did It in the Pretty Young Thing colorway. So that's like one bag. And I did 3 bags of that, of all the different kinds. And I sent it off to her with some extra goodies in it. And then she did the same and sent me these. She just crammed it full. It's so lovely. And oh, I opened it up and was looking at some, like this one. Stephanie, you gotta let me know what this one is, because I want it. So let's try not to make it blow out. But see there, like see those little blips of pinks, hot pinks over this mint blue. Oh, it's beautiful. I want this one, a whole skein of it. And there's, oh, look at the Stellina in this one, the black, which actually it's kind of a little bit of a bluey black, a charcoaly bluey black. Do you like my creaking bones? And this, oh, this beautiful, like, I want to say it's moss green. It kind of reminds me a little bit of acid green, but it's so muted. There's some orangish brown overtones on parts of it. She's got good taste. Oh, this has got to be, just from the twist of it, I would say this is a, what's it called? Socks That Rock mini leftover. I'm not positive, because usually Socks That Rocks have a lot bolder colors, but based off of the base, am I right, Stephanie? Let me know. But then, oh, I know this one. This is Croy sock. I've knit myself some socks from this one. I love that one. So then it looks like this one might be like a Superman colorway, all stripey goodness. I love it. So what am I gonna do with these, you ask? I am going to make the Hexapuff blanket. And I've been meaning to make that for years, literally, ever since it first came out. And I haven't done it. But she also sent along, oh, it's so cute, this oh so fun little popsicle, no, not, what are these called? Suckers? Popsicles? Progress keeper. I've never actually had a progress keeper before. So this is really special. I keep wanting to buy them or make them, and I never do. So I don't know. I don't know if Stephanie made it or if you bought it from somebody, but it's so pretty. In fact, I know the perfect project to put it on. I don't know why I didn't think of this before leaving this out to put it on it. And then she sent me some licorice spice caffeine free herbal tea. And she sent me my favorite, absolute favorite, a needle keeper. You know what? Both of these are gonna go on that project that I'm thinking of. Oh, I love her needle keepers. Look at the little cherries. Look at this. I love her stuff. Okay, now that I've shown you, I can take it all out and I can start using it, right? That's the rule. So in my package to her, I sent her some goodies. And one of the goodies that I sent her was some tea. And she tried it the same night that she got it. And she started texting me. She's like, oh my gosh, what is this tea? You have to tell me. And it was so cute because we were just talking and we talked back and forth about like the properties of the tea and how much we both loved it. And that is the Hot Cinnamon Spice by Harney and Sons tea. And I really love this tea for a number of reasons. The taste is delicious. It's sweet, but then it's got, but then this hot, that hot, oh, the hot cinnamon, it's got this kind of, I want to call it peppery taste, but it's not. It's just so good. Now, I didn't buy this because I knew what it tasted like. I bought this back in December as a natural way to help regulate my blood sugar levels because cinnamon is a natural regulator of that. And it's also good for other things like upset stomachs and things like that. And my husband absolutely loves anything cinnamon, the smell, the taste. He has been known to suck on an actual cinnamon stick in the past. He loves it. So I was like, this is a win-win. It can help me with my blood sugar and, you know, if I have any stomach problems, which, you know, people do. And my husband will like it too. So we love this. Love it. To the point that we bought some other Harney and Sons. I can't remember what they are at the moment, but we bought the, oh my goodness. They're over on in the kitchen, so I can't tell you. But I promised Stephanie that I would share that with you guys because she loved it so much. And you can buy those on Amazon. And then some Barnes & Nobles have them in their coffee shops. I know ours here in the Clackham is small. They have it at in theirs. So that's where we bought a little bit more of one of them. I think we bought a Christmas tea. It was on clearance. So yeah. Now moving on to other things that I did. In case you missed it, I kind of took a trip this last week. Oh wait, no, before I talk about that. Well, okay. I kind of want to talk about, like, my stepson came home the weekend that I published the last episode. My stepson came home from basic training. He graduated, and we're very, very proud of him. And he is a wonderful young man, and he has such a bright future. He's got a really good head on his shoulders. He's being really smart about things. And so we went out to dinner with him and had a really good time with him that weekend. And, you know, he stayed over for the weekend, and I made lots of homemade goodies, oatmeal raisin cookies that he and my husband both just devoured. So that was really nice. And we just had some really good family time. And it was just, I feel very blessed in my husband's son, because he's not mine. He never will be. He's a grown up. I missed his entire childhood, so I can never be his mother or anything, but I can be a friend. And I'm working really hard at, you know, finding my place in his life and just allowing it to flow naturally, not pushing. And I'm hoping that that's being well received. It seems to be. So we'll just see how things go. But I had such a wonderful time with him that weekend, and we got to see him again this last week for a little while. And he and my husband were just making so many jokes and just laughing so hard. It was hilarious. And of course, we went cruising in the new car and stuff. So, you know. Anyway, so I did want to mention that. But then, yes, in case you missed it, I took a trip this weekend with my husband. We went up to Tacoma, the Washington area, and went to a fiber festival up there that happens every year around Valentine's, and it's called the Madrona Fiber Arts Festival. I think I got that right. And there's wonderful teachers and a great marketplace. It's tiny. It's a pretty small marketplace. I mean, you can literally get through the entire marketplace in less than an hour. But the quality of the products at the marketplace is astounding. And so there's lots of people just sitting around in open spaces, spinning and knitting in little groups. And then there's classes going on behind some walls. And then there's the marketplace, and everything is just teeming and wonderful. And I went not knowing a single soul. Now, this is my second time going. The first time I went, I don't know if I told the story in the last podcast. If I did, forgive me, because you're hearing it again. But the first time I went, I had only lived in Portland for a month and a half or less. And I was new from Alaska, and I'd never been to a fiber festival, period. And I wanted to go so badly to one. I was always, okay, I'll be honest, I was jealous. I heard all of these podcasters talking about all of these meetups they went to and these great fiber festivals and retreats and everything. And I was like, oh, we don't have anything like that in Alaska. And I didn't even know if it would be well received if we did have something like that. So I'd never been to one. And so I went. And I signed up for classes, I got myself a hotel room, the whole nine yards. And I went the first day, and I went to the marketplace, and I bought myself a sweater's quantity of something. I can't even remember what. It might have been dragonfly fibers. And while I was in the booth looking at the yarn, I met two wonderful ladies named Lisa and Linda. And it's always been the bane of my existence that I met them at the exact same time. Because they are two completely different individuals. They don't look alike, they don't sound alike, they have completely different life experiences, and yet I cannot seem to name one of them correctly. I call Lisa Linda, and I call Linda Lisa. I don't... So I'm always afraid to say hi and things like that to them because of that. Well, they were just so open and inviting, and they were staying there. And so it was about dinner time. We just teamed up for the rest of the marketplace. And it was about dinner time, and Lisa said, "Oh, hey, I've got a bunch of girlfriends here, and we're all gonna go to dinner. Would you like to join us?" And I was like, "Yes, please. I don't know a single soul." So we went out to dinner and had the best dinner. It was just down the street from the market. And there was about 8 of us, and we were all crowded around these teeny tiny tables and eating appetizers and laughing and knitting. Oh, it was so much fun. And then I went to find my hotel. And I'm new to the area, and it was dark out, and I was driving a stick shift up these really steep hills and down again. And if you've ever been to the Seattle area, the roads are so confusing. It was a miracle I found my hotel, but I did. And I went to bed and everything was great. I had Watson with me. And the next morning I'm ready to go. I pack up everything and I'm going to head out nice and early so I can get there in time for my class. And I head out the door and my car is gone. Gone. I look everywhere. I brought my special blanket with me, and I had my arms full of everything. I think I had my spinning wheel. I'm pretty sure I was carrying my spinning wheel and all this stuff. And I'm wandering around this hotel parking lot like, okay, it was dark out. So, and it is a new car for me. I've only had it for less than a month. Maybe I don't remember where I parked. So I'm wandering around and it finally hits me. It's been stolen. And I just start bawling. And I go inside and I talk to the front desk person. They're like, "What? Seriously?" We call the police, and the cops come like a half an hour later, and they start accusing me and acting as if I'm lying to them that about my car being stolen. And I'm stranded in Tacoma. I don't know a single soul. I don't even really know anybody back home outside of my roommates because classes had just started. I didn't know anybody. I do have a brother in Portland. And so I called him up, and he had a really busy day. And he is the father of 5 kids. And he had a really busy day. I think he was like helping somebody move, or he was supposed to be. And he had all these obligations, but he dropped everything and rushed up to Tacoma to help me. No, we're not doing that. He rushed up to Tacoma to help me and save me and to bring me back to Portland. And, you know, he bought me lunch somewhere. And, you know, we tried to have a better attitude about it. I cried a lot. My car was found a few weeks later, and I did have to go back up to Tacoma, and luckily my roommate was able to take me. They had drained the battery, and a tire was flat, so, you know, I needed to get that taken care of, and there was this goop all over the place. Well, it turns out they'd spilt a soda in there, and then I think they, like, dusted for prints. There was this weird powder all over it, and I had to get it out of from the police and everything, and supposedly the guys went to jail. I got a letter from the detective saying that, you know, I might be asked to testify, and then I never heard anything. So I have no idea what happened. But that's my experience of Tacoma and of the Madrona Fiber Festival. So you can imagine, I didn't get to go to my classes. I didn't get to go back to Madrona. I didn't get a refund on anything. I'm not surprised. It's not their fault. It did leave me a little bit bitter, but... you know, things happen. But I wasn't honestly too keen on going back anytime soon. And I didn't. So it's 3 years later, and I'm now married. I have a support unit here, not all over the place now. I know people. I feel confident in where I live and the people that I know. So, and feel very loved. And So this time going up to Tacoma was a very vastly different experience. We stayed at a nice hotel, which we got ridiculously cheap. It was awesome. And my husband did all the driving. Ka-ching! And we had GPS so that I could be looking at the GPS and be helping him because he hadn't been up to that area in over 20 years. And I was right. The roads are insane. The way that, I mean, they have exits going off left and right. They have merging things. They have 5 lanes, 6 lanes, 7 lanes. They have everything going in and under. They have stuff that goes under the city even. Oh my gosh. How do people live up there? If I thought Portland was bad, no. Actually, I have a brand new take on it now. In fact, I found myself this week not being annoyed when I was stuck in traffic in Portland, because I would rather be stuck in traffic here and feel confident in my surroundings than in Seattle and Tacoma area any day of the week. In fact, we actually made the decision that no, we won't be looking to be moving up there ever. I just can't handle it. It's not our kind of place. But the Madrona Fiber Arts Fair was our kind of place and was our kind of people. And I made a rule, that a couple rules. One, I set myself a budget. So you can't see my one. One, I set myself a budget. And two, I said, okay, you can't buy anything until you have gone to every booth, which wasn't a large calling or a terrible task. Every booth, and then make an informed, wise decision. Because if you go to the first booth and just blow all your money, what if you see something later on and you wish you'd saved your money for that? And I felt really good about that. My husband was a great support about it. He even reminded me on a couple occasions. I actually had to be reminded of my goal. And so I kept moving through. And I actually bought some things that were really surprising to me. But at the same time, I'm extremely happy with my purchases. I don't feel like I left anything behind that I regret. And I feel that I made some wonderful connections because I didn't feel rushed. I didn't feel pressured that I needed to see and buy and do. I was there for the experience. And I met some awesome people. The people who own Hanson's Mini Spinners, Kevin and Deb. I think his wife's name is Deb. We talked to Kevin the whole time we were there. And then Lynn, who owns a spinning mill. And we talked to, oh my gosh, I lost her name. Cass, oh darn it, because I want to get her name right. Hold on, guys. Candace, yes. One of the, ooh, I did it. Candace. And then we, at one point during the day, we've discovered that with me and my diabetes, if I eat breakfast at 7, if I eat it at 8, it doesn't matter. By 11, 11:30-ish, I have to eat something or my blood sugar will drop dramatically and I'll start shaking. And lots of things, and I'll feel very ill the rest of the day. Well, we were so into the whole thing that I completely forgot to eat. And I didn't even bring any snacks from the car. And the car was parked, I don't know, a couple blocks away and in the rain, and we just didn't want to do that. Anyway, so all of a sudden, I'm talking with somebody, and I start getting kind of woozy and lightheaded, and I realize, oh crap, I have to eat. So I tell my husband, we exit the marketplace, and we go down and we get me a banana, and because we thought, you know, load up on sugars just in case I'm low, because we also didn't have my meter with us. So we got ourselves a banana and a Kit Kat and a bunch of water, and we sat down and ate that. We got something else a little later because that didn't seem to finish it off. I can't remember because I was still shaky. And I wasn't with it. Does that make sense? But we were resting up after doing that, and all of a sudden, I look over, and who do I see? It's Lisa. Yes, Lisa. Madrona? Yeah. It was Lisa. Okay. It was Lisa, and she was over in the corner, and she was spinning. Oh my gosh. She looked so freaking good. Like, because this woman has gone through a lot of trials in her life, and she's just the most beautiful soul, and I was so excited. We both squealed and rushed each other and hugged, and I was so grateful to see her, and she just bought a spinning wheel that needed... She likes to buy spinning wheels that need sprucing up, and then she sells them on. So she just bought one of those, and she was sitting in the corner checking it out, getting the feel of it, seeing what she would need to do and stuff. And so it was just wonderful to run into her, and we just talked and talked and talked, and then we parted ways so I could go back into the marketplace and do some shopping. And then we met up in the marketplace, and then we parted ways, and then we met up again out there because I bought something really, really exciting, which I won't talk about any of my purchases until Toolbox, okay? Yes, we're at 30 minutes, folks. Well, almost 29 minutes, and we haven't gotten into the knitting yet, but you're just, you know, it's all good. Suffice it to say, I had an amazing time at Madrona. I felt the warmth and the acceptance of people that I'd never met before, but we had fiber in common. We had knitting in common, and that's what drew us together. And based off of that commonality, we made friendships. And that continued through the whole weekend. So the next morning, I had pre-planned to meet up with an Instagram friend named Kathy. She's the owner of Intrepid Otter. I can never say that right. Intrepid Otter Yarns, and she does self-striping yarns, and it's absolutely gorgeous. Hopefully, I'll insert a picture here of maybe her website or a skein of her yarn that I own. And I had some things that I wanted to give her from when I was in business, and we've been trying to get together for a couple months now, and just wasn't working out. And it just so happens that she has a farm outside of the state capital of Olympia, and so we said, okay, well, we'll come and meet you at your farm. And I'm like, yes, get to go to a farm. Yep. She had to do some errands, so we were killing time, and we stopped off in Olympia, the state capital, and because it was President's Day weekend, and or maybe this is just a normal thing, I'm not sure, but the state capital was open and free to visitors. There was free tours, the whole nine yards, and it was so fun. My husband and I wandered around for, I don't know, an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours, I'm not sure. In the state capitol, and he was very interested in learning about who was a legislator, who was on the legislature and stuff, and I was just interested in the architecture and the beautiful pieces around and stuff. So I'm not interested in the politics at all. But in our wanderings and exploration, we were in the basement where... That's where all the legislature's offices are. I felt so bad for the guys. They're in the basement. But anyway, we found a penny pressing machine. I don't know if that's what it's called, but that's what I'm calling it. And I remember back when I was a little girl, whenever my family would go on travels, and we took a year trip where my parents piled us into the motorhome. Not all of the kids, because the two oldest were already off and on their own, but us four younger kids, they piled us into the motorhome, and we traveled around the United States for a whole year. And one of the things that we did in our travels was when we found a penny press machine, we would press pennies and save them. And so Chris and I had such a fun time. Let's make sure it's upright. This is Chris's of the state capitol. And this is mine of the state bird. And we did that. We had so much fun doing it. I don't know where the pennies went from when I was a little girl. I'm gonna talk to my mom about that. Maybe she still has them. I kind of doubt it. But I decided that this is something else that Chris and I are gonna do. We have a lot of things that I say that we're gonna do, like, and he goes along with it. He's so nice. I say, we're gonna go and visit all of the lighthouses on the West Coast, and we're gonna go, I don't even remember the other things. There were other things. But this is now on our list wherever we go. And I'm going to keep it in a keepsake box. And I don't know, somehow I'm going to tag it or something. But that's just a little wonderful souvenir that we got from that day. It was really fun. And then we went to Kathy's farm. And I gave her the few of my things I wanted to give her. And then she gave us a tour of her dye studio, which was really cool. I never had anything like she had. And it was time to feed the sheep. So what was I going to do but join in? And they had all just been sheared the day before, so they were a little cold. It was rainy out and all this kind of stuff. So we went and fed the sheep, and I got some video footage that I took of that part, and I think Chris took some video footage of a different part. I'm not sure. But then we went and saw the lambs out in the field and fed them, and oh my gosh, it was so much fun. We met the cows, which were so adorable. And then she had some new chicks that she had in her house, and so we went and saw the chicks, and I think Chris got a picture of me. I know Kathy did. Got a picture of me holding chicks. And I have a thing with birds. I love birds. I love the sound of birds. I love watching for birds. I really want to learn more about them. But for some odd reason, my motivation isn't there. But I do love it. However, I am scared to death of touching birds, of holding them. And so it took a lot for me to do it, but as soon as I held one little chick in my hands, I was like, I never want to let you go. It was just the most amazing day, and she gave me some parting gifts, which again I'll talk about in the toolbox, but I just, it was just the best weekend. It was really hard to come back and come back to normal life, regular life. Oh, I totally forgot. We also witnessed a guy proposing to his girlfriend at lunch, which we went to. Where did we go to lunch? Famous Dave's. We really liked their barbecue. And this guy was there, and he was kind of announcing to the whole restaurant that he was about to propose to his girlfriend. And I was like, what? What's going on? I'm so confused. If he's gonna propose to his girlfriend, shouldn't he keep that quiet? Apparently she had gone off to the restroom with her son. Comes back out, and I quickly got out my phone and I started video recording and I posted it on Instagram and stuff. I'm so corny. But she said yes. And I just thought it was so wonderful, because when he was proposing to her, first he asked her sons for their permission to be their stepdad. And that made my heart go pitter-pat. So that was our weekend. And then this week has just been full of work and work, work, and work, and play. I will say, I have been playing a lot with the things that I got this last weekend. But, okay, before we go into